My name is Richard Trevor Martin. I was born on the 15th of March 1923 in Malvern in Victoria, Australia. My parents moved then to Sydney when I was a very young baby, and I grew up in Sydney until 1966 when I moved then up to Queensland with my family. When the war started, all of us young people were then expected to be turning up for and joining the different services, the Army, the Air Force. At the age of 17, I decided I'd put an application in for the Royal Australian Air Force. And subsequently, I got a letter back saying that thank you for your application, but the entry age for the Air Force is 18 years. So if you wish to reapply when you turn 18. But in the meantime, the Army had started to take in all the young 18-year-olds. They had to all register because Japan had entered the war, and all the young 18-year-olds and above were all supposed to register, which I did duly registered. And in due course, on the 5th of February 1943, I had received a call up, like so many other young men, to attend the hall at Cogra in New South Wales to be interviewed and for the Army. So we all turned up at 8 o'clock in the morning with we had instructed to be come with some plates and forks and knives and cups and underwear and change of clothing and all that sort of thing. And so we all turned up at the hall, and they took all our particulars. And at about 10:15 in the morning, they said, "Righto, get yourselves down to Cogra Railway Station and wait there until we give you orders of what to do." So we all trundled down to the Cogra Railway Station, and the next thing, a special train pulled in for us. We got on number one platform, and there was an old steam train, steam engine, with so many carriages behind, and we were all told, "All you blokes get on board this, and we're going for a short ride in the train." So we all got on board there, and about half an hour, three quarters of an hour later, we ended up at a station called Ingleburn. And we all told her, "Righto, boys, out you get, take all your gear with you. You're going for a small march now." So we all gathered on the road outside the station and formed up. And they said, "Righto, boys, quick march, we're going for a little walk." So about half an hour, three quarters of an hour later, we all marched up the final hill and marched into Ingleburn Army Camp. Well, there's the usual call as we march in, "You'll be sorry," from all the boys that were up there. Anyhow, it was getting close to lunchtime when we arrived, so we did that. And of course, as we go past the cooks that are dealing out, there's some lovely big sausages, curry sausages it was, big slab of bread and butter, and the usual cup of tea, and go and sit yourself down. Well, the boys were that famished from hunger. They hadn't had anything to eat since they got up that morning, unless some of them ate their cut lunch on the way. But we all sat down, and that was the most enjoyable meal I think all the boys, especially myself, enjoyed at that time. Then they say, "Righto, now you're going to be allocated to your sleeping accommodation. Go and get a palliass." Now, a palliass is a great big Hessian bag which you put straw in. That's your mattress. But so that went on in the Army for quite a while, and it was quite an enjoyable thing for myself, because shortly after I was in there, all the clerical people were asked to report to the orderly room, And so, which we did, and we were given a test of our writing and our figure work and all this. And the next thing I'm told, you're going to report to the quartermaster. To me, so I reported to the quartermaster, met him, and he was quite a nice person. And he said, righto, you're going to be my clerk in here. And that's the next thing. I spent every day I was in the quartermaster's store. I'd go and get my food, top of the line, go and get it. You take it back to wherever you want to eat it. So there was no waiting in lines, there was no marching. Oh, I did a little bit of marching in the beginning of it. So the next thing I'm told, you're going to go up, you're going to be sent up to Cobar for a quartermaster's course. And the date happened to be that I got on the train to go to Cobar was the day that the Japanese submarines came into Sydney Harbour. And that caused a bit of confusion, but of course we didn't know the news up at Cobar until a day or two later of what had happened. I was in the army for 6.5 months, and then I got a call from the Air Force. I was to report to the Air Force, learning all about the Air Force and doing your marching and all that sort of business. I thought I might become a pilot because my coordination was it was above average, but they must have thought your coordination would be better being an air gunner, wireless air gunner. So that was the job that I was allocated to. And then of course I was sent to do the Morse and all that, but I'd rather listen to the radio than listen to the Morse coming through. So of course I didn't pass the Morse part of it. So they made me as just a straight out air gunner. At the end of February in 43, and I was then a sergeant, and you'd said, right, you're on embarkation leave now. Said goodbye to the family, which was early in the morning, and they're all in bed, of course, and I'm up, dressed, ready to go, catch the train to go to Bradfield Park, and that was the last I saw of them for quite a while. But anyhow, on the way, the next morning, when the train was on the way to Brisbane, we pulled into a big station, and then we went on further and got out at South Brisbane Railway Station. That was as far as the trains went in those days. That was 1943. And then from there onto a bus, and the bus took us down to Hamilton on the river at Brisbane. And we see this American ship there. So we all loaded on board that ship, and as soon as we were all on board, we were the only ones that was going to take. And the ship started to move away from the wharf and move down the river. And of course, during the course down the river, they started to play White Christmas, and of course, that brought a few tears to the boys. Especially me, I know, I had tears in my eyes because I was saying goodbye to Australia. And of course, we didn't know if we were going to ever come back again. The trip across the Pacific was quite pleasant. The American ship, there's nothing wrong with it. You slept in hammocks, of course. The food was reasonable, and all we had to do was, certain number of us, we had to do watch certain, you know, submarine watch, 4 hours on, 12 hours off, or 8 hours off sort of thing. So in different parts of the ship we were allocated to, and the bridge each side and all this sort of thing. And I was on watch for, you know, doing my part of it, and that was reasonable enough. We didn't mind that. The weather was quite reasonable. Each morning, though, we'd have to get up early, and at dusk, because they said that's the time when the Japanese submarines usually attack if they're in the vicinity. But anyhow, we didn't have any problems like that. And we pulled into San Francisco, I think it was about the 5th of May or the 3rd of May that year. And of course, the next thing we're told, right, we've got to go over to Berkeley, which is a part of San Francisco, where we have to catch a train. So we eventually got over to Berkeley, and we're loaded onto a Pullman train, you know, the American type train, the Pullman, where your sleeping accommodation is above your seat sort of thing. But anyhow, we're about 3 or 4 days on the train going across, and you have the Negro waiters serving you, you know, at meal times in the dining car. And of course, at the end of the trip, we all threw in so much money because that's the only way the darkies get paid, really. I don't think they get very much from the railway, so they depend on passengers' tips, you know, and all that. But anyhow, we eventually got over to the east side of America, New York, where we had to change there and get into another train to take us down to Fort Miles Standish, which was in Massachusetts. So we were to stay there until a ship was ready for us to take us across to England. But I enjoyed being in America. The people there, they were very nice to us and very hospitable. But anyhow, the time came for us, which was the 24th of May, that we were to go to New York and get on this. It was the Esperance Bay, an old British ship. Well, of course, you can tell the snobbery part of things when you got on a British ship. All the passengers got in, they were dining in the saloon, and the old, poor old Aussie airmen, they had a little space down the back and a special cookhouse down the back for their meals. And that's where they had their meals, down in the back quarters of the boat. But fortunately, at that time, the German submarines had been recalled because of their losses, and Admiral Dönitz was going to give all the crews a bit of a rest. We did keep a bit of a watch all the time, you know, but we're in a big convoy of ships, so all of us boys got out of Bristol, onto a train there, down to London, and then from London, of course, you had to walk then to another area where the trains ran to the south coast of England, from London down to Brighton and all those places. So we had to march across to that particular station, then we're on a train again down, and we ended up at a place called Brighton in England. Well, Brighton was where Australia had two hotels for special use by the Australian troops coming in, airmen or army. There weren't many army men, but mainly Air Force. We had the Grand and the Metropole, so we were allocated to either one or the other. And we spent a few days while we were down in Brighton until they knew what to do with us, where we were to be sent and all that sort of thing. So after a few pub crawls around the place, the boys didn't have much money to spend, of course. They had a number of the pilots, navigators, radio operators, and all this. Well, they were all told, now get out there and get yourselves all crewed up. So of course, there's a, you know, we're all a mixed lot too. We're, you know, there's also English boys as well as Australian boys and all that, Canadians. So the pilots come around, they get the first, you know, they pick out who they want, the navigator, you would like to be with me, radio operator, bombardier and all that, and then they eventually come back to they picked the gunners up last. They picked me up, one of the group picked me up. I made the fourth Aussie in the crew. And so that was the crew that we started with as flying in Wellington bombers. Of course, the Wellington was the main aircraft that the crews were started on up there until they learnt enough and then could be transferred over to usually the four engine heavies like the Lancasters and Stirlings and all, Halifaxes and all that. And you know, I had the three other Aussie boys, and I think there was a there's two English. The navigator was English, and the flight engineer, he was English. That was the six of us. And we did our training and got on quite well and all that sort of thing. And then we're ready then to do what they call a bullseye, which was a training to see how you would go if you were to do a bombing operation. You're given a bombing area where you're to find your way to, you plot your course and all that sort of thing. And all the rest of it, you drop I think it's a miniature dud bomb or something on a special target to see how close you were and all that. But anyhow, in the course, I was in the rear turret, of course, on this trip, the bullseye we were doing. And I started to develop pains in the stomach and cramps and all that. And I said to the pilot, I think I'll crawl out of the turret and lay inside the aircraft because I've got these pains and cramps. And he said, okay then, so I call out. And he sent the radio operator down to see how I was. And I said, oh, look, I'll stay here for a while until these pains subside. But the captain must have notified base, and then he was told to return to base. You can't have an ill airman on board. The next day I was in bed, and the boys from my crew called in to see how I was, and they said, how are you today? We've got to go out again today to do what we didn't finish yesterday. Are you okay to come with us? And I said, oh, look, I just can't get out of bed and start dressing and come with you. You'll have to go and see the doctor or whoever's in charge and just see what's what. So they come back a little while later and said, no, you've got to stay in bed here. So we'll have to go and borrow somebody as our rear gunner, and we'll see you tomorrow then. Well, tomorrow never came for them. They went out that night and they crashed into the ocean. And so that was rather a distressing point, because there are a decent lot of people, boys and that. And and the next thing I'm told, you've got to report to the AOC of the base. So you'll be looking for another crew now, I assume. There's a crew we have. They're a six-man crew, and they want a seventh man because they'll be going onto Lancasters in due course shortly. And he said, would you like to join them? So I said, oh yes, I may as well. So I joined them, and there was four officers and three NCOs, including myself. So we were sent up to a nearby squadron, which was 625. So we turned up at 625 squadron, and of course there was heavy snowing going on at that time, and of course we couldn't go out flying very much at all. They ended up having us all with shovels, trying to shovel snow out from some of the runway, or not the runway so much, but some of where the aircraft had been, you know, in the standing area where the aircraft were, so that the aircraft could get out onto the main tarmac and all that sort of thing. But anyhow, that didn't suit us very much at all. But sleeping, the accommodation we had was in a big hut, and of course we had a little fire at one end and a little fire at the other end, and where the crew were sleeping in that, and it was cold, like sleeping in a bloody ice chest. And there was one flight we had to do. We were on 625 squadron, and it was the middle of winter, and we were told we were going to do a long haul to Augsburg, which was near the Swiss border, not far from the Swiss border. And there was an engine, the MAN Engine Works, M-A-N. They were making the engines for submarines and all that sort of thing. And that was going to be our target at Augsburg. So, of course, we were loaded up with, we had a 4,000-pound cookie on board, you know, a delayed action cookie. It was like two big 44-gallon drums welded together, you know, full of explosive and all that sort of thing. a delayed action, which really was there to so that we could get away quickly, you know, from any blast that might have come from that when we dropped it. So anyhow, we found our target and dropped our cookie and also a load of HE bombs and some incendiaries, and then we made our way off again to get out of the road. And we encountered a bit of flak here and there, but fortunately we weren't held up with anything and we got back with any further trouble. And the next day after we'd landed and reported in and all that, we had a look at our aircraft, and the rear tailplane had a big hole in it where a lump of flak must have gone through and torn part of it, but it didn't affect us in any way. We got back quite safely, and that was that. And that was about the last the last operation I did there. I'd been up in the mid-upper turret, and I wasn't real comfortable. I'd been used to the rear turret, and I had the feeling quite often that the aircraft was going to flip over, you know, because I'm sitting right up on top of the aircraft sort of thing with a view all around, and I had that feeling all the time that perhaps the aircraft was going to suddenly flip over. But anyhow, I reported that, and I come off flying after that, and in due course I was sent to our headquarters in London to serve in the casualty records department there. So that was my finish of my flying in those days. After I was grounded, they completed two operations, and on the fifth operation they shot down coming back from the target, and the pilot realised that they weren't going to make it, they wouldn't make it across the channel, so it was best that they all bail out over Europe. So he gave the order to bail out, and of course the two gunners, with nothing much else to do, they arranged to get out fairly quickly, the rear gun and the mid-upper. And then the flight engineer, he came down the back and got out the side, the big side door of the aircraft, while the four officers up the front, the pilot held the aircraft as much as he could level so that everyone could bail out. And the officers went through, there was a trap door in the floor of the front section of the aircraft where the front crew could go straight through, you know. So they donned their parachutes and went through the door on the floor of the front of the aircraft. So everyone got out safely out of the aircraft before it crashed. And the four officers were picked up by the Gestapo, I don't know how long after, but the three NCOs that had got out a bit earlier than the officers, they were got picked up by the French underground, the three of them, and they got moved into safe houses before the Germans. This might have been in the Vichy area of France at that time. See, the part of France come under Vichy. But anyhow, the underground got hold of them, put them in safe houses, and then gradually when the Germans might have been looking for them, but I'm not sure, but they had the four officers. And so eventually they got from safe house to safe house, down to the Spanish border, and then across to the Portuguese border. And the RAF had been notified that there was three airmen waiting to be picked up, taken back. So they sent an aircraft over and picked them up, took them back home, and of course the rear gunner came looking for me in Australia House when he got back there to then let me know what had happened to them. So he turned up one day, just fortunate that I was there, and he told me what had happened, you know, and after that, that was the last I saw of him, because he said that I think they send them all back wherever they came from once they've been, you know, shot down and escaped, because if they go on another time over Europe and they happen to crash and the Germans know their names and all that, and they realise that they can torture them to see who helped them get, you know, in the escape way. So that's why they never let go back again on the second time. And then after that, of course, the V2s were the next thing to start hitting London. Well, the V2s were the worst of the lot because you didn't know a bloody thing of what had... All you knew was there's a bloody great flash and a big explosion. That's when that had hit the ground. You didn't, because it come down from miles up sort of thing, and just straight down and bang. There's no way you could do anything about it. It was just if Hitler had a lot of those, he could have done a bloody lot of damage, I tell you, and the people wouldn't have really known how to combat them at all. Yeah, so that was, I was there until the end of the war, really, in headquarters in London, yeah, so. I met my wife in Sydney, we got married and we built our home, and my wife, of course, she was unfortunate, couldn't have any children herself, nor could her sister. We put in for adoption of a boy and a girl. We were allowed, our boy was the first one we could get. My wife was, she was home with her and with him, and of course raised him. And then 2 years later we got our daughter. And then of course we had the two children to raise it and all that. And of course they naturally become your own type of thing, you know. You don't look on them as adopted, they just, you look at them as your own now. And I've still got my son and my daughter. My wife did die. She went to work at a plant nursery. After the kids had grown up and gone to school a bit, she decided she wanted to find something to do with herself of a day. So she looked up a couple of, she was interested in nursery work, you know, plant work and all this. She was a keen gardener. So she found a place that decided that she could go and work for them there. And she started, and she was there for 10 years. But in that meantime, were they spraying all this poison around the plants and all that, and she was pulling plants out, no covering over her arms or anything like that. And of course the poison started to get into her system and into her bones, and she got leukemia out of it. As soon as they discovered she had leukemia, she lasted for 3 weeks and was gone. So I haven't had a wife ever since. And in 1980, I joined this sub-branch, and I've been a member ever since. And then they asked me to be the treasurer of the sub-branch here in 1983. So I was their treasurer here for 24 years. The government decided to put an advertisement in the paper for a design of a badge for the Returned Servicemen Association. So my grandfather, being a designer, and he used to design the notes that they use and all that sort of thing, and he was an engraver, and he decided he'd go into this competition. So he made his design up, and he won the competition. So that was the design that he was much the same as that, but it only had the two soldier and a sailor on it. They were the only two people in those days. Of course, the females were only nurses, really. There was no WAFs and all this sort of thing in those days. And the airmen were part of the army. So that was only the army and the navy, the only two subjects on the badge, the original badge. But then in due course, when the Second World War came, and of course we had the third, we had the Air Force as another force, and then we had all the women who were in the forces as well, you know, and their particular units. So that's where the four people now come on the newer one, the newer design which was done. But the original design was by my grandfather, and they call it then the RSS and SIL of A sort of thing. Yeah, that was the original Returned Soldiers, Sailors and Airmen's Imperial League of Australia. But then of course they shortened it down to Returned Service League as the final, you know, to shorten it up a bit. No, I was just happy to do my part. I mean, it might not have been as great as I really intended, but you know, in the flying side of things. But I was very lucky, as I say, I was very lucky to come home again, really. And like so many of the boys that went over, they just didn't come back, which was very sad. But I was very lucky that I came back, and I appreciate that, and that's why I try to, you know, do the best I can for the boys that are left that come in here and all that sort of thing. And I was just thankful that I was able to come home again, really. I was very fortunate. I must say I've had a very fortunate life. I just hope all the young ones these days that can grow up in a good country, which is one of the best countries we've got, and everyone should appreciate it, really. But that's all I can say. Do your best you can for your country and your people. Thank you very much for listening.